When George Lucas created Star Wars: A New Hope in 1977, an entire galaxy came with it. In that galaxy, Jedi, the wise moral guides who reflect in meditation and serve as defenders of the weak. And they get to wield lightsabers. Who wouldn't want to wield a lightsaber?
Elegant weapon, but a more civilized age.
In the past few decades, the teachings of the Jedi have become powerful enough to transcend fiction. Alan Wilson says he was moved by the Jedi, even the first time he saw Star Wars.
You know, of course, I mean, I'm old enough that I actually saw Star Wars in the theater when it first released. And there was just something about Obi-Wan in the original movie that I was, you know, 8, 9 years old. He was very impressionable. I loved his whole attitude.
Despite the initial appeal Wilson felt, his involvement was limited to the secular side of the Star Wars fandom. He joined roleplay servers in the 90s and cosplayed at small fan conventions. But the release of the prequels, beginning in 1999, further influenced his beliefs.
We're now seeing the Jedi all throughout these movies and getting better role models to pattern ourselves from. And so then that's when I started becoming serious. About the end of the 90s, beginning of 2000, that's when I said, hey, you know what? This is what I am.
For Wilson, Jediism has now become a way of life. Unlike many faiths, Jediism has no unified location or leadership. It's split into several different orders around the world. Wilson's order is located in St. Louis, Missouri. There are several others spread throughout the United States in places like Texas, Kentucky, Wisconsin, and Florida. Many Jedi in England wrote the faith as their religion in the 2001 census, putting the practice in the public eye. Jedi in Milan officialized ludosport, a sport which is, essentially, a lightsaber duel. And groups reach all the way to New Zealand, a country actively advocating for Jedi census numbers.
Similarly to the fiction, each Jedi order contains different ranks of Jedi at different levels of training. Wilson explains it this way.
You can look at the Jedi Order just like a modern-day church. Mm-hmm. Your Padawans would be like your pages and your altar boys. Your Padawans are those that go, hey, you know, I think I want to train in this religious lifestyle. Then your knights would be equivalent to like your deacons. You know, they kind of run things. They're out there in public getting stuff done. They're helping teach the new members. Then you have your masters, which would be like your priests, your preachers, pastors and the such.
The training to advance through these ranks varies based on the order, though the main difference is whether the training takes place online or offline. The Temple of the Jedi Order, based in Texas, has an intensive online program. They ask every member to create an online journal through their website, where they'll post answers to introspective questions about the Jedi teachings. A leader checks over the works and allows for advancement of rank. They say it takes a little over a year to become a Jedi Knight. Wilson does most of his training in person. He's one of three Jedi Masters in his St. Louis-based order, Arcanea.
Arcanea has 125 members, 38 of whom are currently in training. They meet frequently to train together in various ways. Often, group sessions include practicing light martial arts, such as yoga or lightsaber sparring, or meditating in the Force together. This is only in addition to the individual practice these Jedi practice daily. Wilson says that he and others try to meditate once in the morning and once at night. Additionally, they own ceremonial robes for special occasions and often wear a mixture of khaki and black as an unofficial uniform. Wilson's other Jedi ministry, apart from his leadership role as a master, is hosting a Friday night show on Jedi Realist Radio.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Arcanea Friday Nights.
When they're doing this training, what exactly is it that they're studying? What do Jedi believe?
And we literally took everything we could from the fiction and translated it into things that were practical for us today.
The code that most orders follow contains many different sections: 3 tenets, the creed, 21 maxims, and 16 teachings. Some of the teachings are as follows. Jedi maintain a clear mind, which can be achieved through meditation and contemplation. Jedi are guardians of peace.
we believe in helping all those that are in need, in whatever form, to the best of our ability. Jedi are patient. Jedi have integrity. These teachings are built around a belief in the Force, an energy that flows through and around all living things, that can be recognized internally and used for good.
You must feel the Force around you. Two, three to you, me, three, around, everywhere.
On the Temple of the Jedi Order's website is the following disclaimer, just before the code is listed. Real Jedi do not worship George Lucas or Star Wars or anything of the sort. Jediism is not based in fiction, but we accept myth as a sometimes more practical means of conveying philosophies applicable to real life. The question remains, then, where the line is between fiction and real-life practice.
Do we believe in telekinesis? Sure we do. We believe it's possible. Are there any proven examples? No. Am I going to teach you to go out in the backyard in your swamp and lift an X-Wing out of it?
He's referencing this scene from The Empire Strikes Back, in which Yoda asks Luke to raise his sinking X-Wing from the water. Luke fails, and so Yoda shows him what's possible with the Force.
X-Wings haven't been invented. You know, by the time X-Wings are invented, somebody may actually be able to lift one out of a swamp with their mind.
In that way, for the Jedi, anything is possible. It's certainly an attractive part of the faith, but what ultimately makes the practice so attainable is its versatility and universality.
I think the key that makes Jediism or Jedi realism different than everything else out there is the fact that you can be a Jedi, or you can be a Christian Jedi, you can be a Muslim Jedi. You know, there is no... And that's one of the things that's taught. There is no right way or wrong way to do it. There are these basic core values that we hold dear. There is the code that we learn to interpret. But after that, the spiritual side of it is all yours.